8-6, one even for Frazier. 9-6 for Frazier. 11 rounds for Frazier, for Larry. The winner by unanimous decision, Joe Frazier.
For the first time in his career, Muhammad Ali was beaten.
I wasn't happy at all.
Why not?
Well, I'm a Muhammad Ali fan, and he just let me down.
Good fight, very good fight. But considering the way Clay fought, I don't even like it.
I thought it was terrific. Best fight I ever saw.
Best fight I ever seen. I've seen him for a long, long time. Clay's twice the man I thought he was.
Very good.
But
really
it was
terrific.
Good decision. Good decision.
It's a very good fight. Very good.
Good fight.
Worth the money. And worth every penny I paid. Every penny.
I don't even feel like waking up tomorrow. Now behind that fight. Oh, that's seriously. That's really upsetting to me.
Well, don't worry about it. We'll be back. Them 3 years ain't gonna be 3 years no more. We coming right back to war. And now when we come back, we're gonna have to really take the title from a champ. Joe Frazier tonight have beat a champion. And he is the champion of the world, without a doubt.
Before the championship fight with Joe Frazier, I never considered you like a brutal fighter. And I don't want to say it like that, but I thought you outpointed Frazier.
Right. Well, you know, I thought I won 9 rounds. Yeah. I've seen people protest after decisions, and it really don't help. So I'll just do better next time. I think I played too much with Joe Frazier. I played 3 rounds I shouldn't have played. I didn't stay on my feet and move like I should have. And trying to prove he couldn't hurt me standing in the corners. And this, I lost the fight like this. Judges took it. And one judge gave him 11 rounds of me, just 4. But at the time, I hadn't won my draft case, and being one black man in the million-dollar bracket who tells it like it is and, you know, stays with his own kind, naturally, they gonna pick the best boy to give it to him. But the next time, I've learned a lesson. The next time, there will be no doubt, for he must go out.
Well, I'm training for fights. I don't like to be surrounded in plushness and luxury, like the Fontainebleau Hotel and the Hilton and all those places. You know, you have the beautiful soft carpets, you have the chandeliers, and, you know, you order room service, and the beds are so nice, and you got the mirrors, and it makes you soft. So I had to find a place that wasn't too plush. And this is why I've just built a training camp in Deer Lake, Pennsylvania, right outside Redding. I built a 50 by 60, a log cabin, and I bought my 3 acres of land. I have my camp there. It's rugged.
Those living close to nature, in the solitude, my peasants living in the country, have greater intuition than educated people living in the midst of city life. Why? I'm breathing fresh air. My mind is clear. I'm drinking fresh water from the ground, God water. The food that I eat, the vegetables, are not frozen and sprayed. It's from farm down the road. So I'm nourishing my mind and my soul and my thoughts with clean air, real water, and real food. That's why they say God's prophet and wise men go up and meditate, go on top of a mountain, and they fast, go eat, they think about it, and they can, things just come to them. We
we've seen a lot of camps been all over the world. You know, usually above a bar, above a strip joint, above a drugstore, connected with something, a resort, but it's never the thing. Now, this is the thing. This is a fighter's camp. So that's what Muhammad's doing. Where the reception is Muhammad, the designer is Muhammad, the architect's Muhammad, the whole schmear.
I want it real rusty. Whole floor, the wood we're using, no electricity, nothing modern.
Right. You're putting windows out here with the view?
Two nice windows where you see the view.
Yeah.
Whose name is going to be pinned on the big black rock over there?
Jack Johnson.
It's Jack Johnson?
Most black world heavyweight champion. Yeah. The big white rock on the end is Rocky Marciano.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And Joe Louis, the big rock right from the gym. Mm.
See, this is going to be a well-integrated camp. Half and half. Black and white champions.
What kind of training are you doing up here?
I'm running up and down mountain in these big boots. I'm chopping down these trees every day, as you see up through here, and I'm ready.
What kind of shape are you in? You in good shape?
Looking for a few bears. I heard of some bears loose around here somewhere. So I'm going to catch a few wild bears and whoop them too. I'm in good shape. I'm ready. I'm in top-notch shape. I'm out to get my title back from the new champ, Joe Frazier. I'm the real champion, and I'm going to prove it. And I'll see you now. I got to go chop down some more trees.
Okay.
Out here somewhere. More trees back over here somewhere.
This is Golden State is giving me the incentive to keep going. This is like a new life, you know. Coming here, going to the gym when I want. Got my own cooks in the kitchen, my own bunkhouses, my own crew. Fresh air, fresh water, peace, looking at the view. Can't beat it. I didn't know it would be this nice when I first got there, but it's nice.
Muhammad, in the past, you've been highly critical of the American system. In view of the decision today by the Supreme Court, how do you feel about our system now?
Well, all I have to say is what's concerning my case. I don't know what's happening at this moment. I don't know who will be assassinated tonight. I don't know who will be enslaved or mistreated. I don't know who will be deprived of some other justice or equality. So I can't say nothing. All I can talk about is my case. And I'm thankful that the courts recognized my sincerity and my beliefs in this case.
Once he was a very great fighter, now he is a worn relic of the past, a faded hero of yesteryear, but still mouthing words that he can no longer employ the skills to back up. And he still proclaims to be that which he is no longer, the heavyweight champion of the world. So I am going to bring out the former heavyweight champion of the world, Muhammad Ali.
Howard, every time you open your mouth, you should be arrested for air pollution.
Jimmy Ellis was one of Muhammad Ali's favorite sparring partners. In 1967, I asked Ellis about his dreams for the future. You enjoy sparring with the heavyweight champion?
Yeah, well, when I box with him, I know I'm boxing with the best.
You probably know more about Muhammad Ali's habits and style than anybody else.
Yeah, I think I know quite a bit about it.
Ellis took his sparring instructions from Angelo Dundee, who is now training him for the Ali fight.
I'll come out the winner if I'm in shape. But what worries me now is this belly I got. It just won't come out.
What about some of that poetry of yours?
After I defeat Ellis in the Astrodome, I'm going to run him and Angelo home.
1 minute remaining in this fight. Ellis is reeling. The referee may be deciding whether he's going to stop the fight. He is stopping the fight.
What's the word on Frazier?
Frazier's not actually doing too much right now. They forced him to take a fight. And still look like I might not come off with a one win because I've got one more shot at Joe Frazier.
Muhammad, why couldn't you put him away? Did you hold back?
Anybody in the world could have seen that man was finished and just letting him stay there was public crucifixion. And I hope the judgment systems that we have around here will stop fighting to see people hurt because as soon as one killed, they want to say you wouldn't go to the army to fight for your country and you don't like to kill, then why did you kill that man?
All right.
So leave me alone and shut up and be glad you saw a good fight. We're after Joe Frazier. and he's running, he's ducking, and he's talking about he won't fight for a few years. And I hope the public bring him on out with that title and defend it like I did. I'm still resurrecting the game, although they say I'm not the champion.
Muhammad, knock him out. What's the matter with you?
They're stopping it for the protection of the lad himself.
What a showman. Look at that. This must be one of the most unique fighters in heavyweight history.
The world's greatest heavyweight, Muhammad Ali.
Yeah, Captain Aston Angelo, then these roundhouses are going. He said, shit, could be close, but you're winning.
Then I looked up and saw Sammy Davis Jr. ringside, unannounced. And when a man this great takes time out to come to see you, how can you lose?
Ali at 221, fighting the sixth-ranked heavyweight Kenny Norton at 210. You haven't heard much about Norton, and this is supposed to be a routine exercise for Ali. Ali is wearing 10-ounce gloves, as Norton will be. That's the way it is in California, and 10-ounce gloves are a worry because they can really punish a man. The bell for round one. Norton in the early going should show a pretty good left jab. His best punch is a left hook. The man with the highest total points wins the fight. Good left there by Norton. That excited the crowd.
I have a habit of playing in the ring with opponents, you know. Mm-hmm. It seemed to be so easy to hit, and sometimes I just like to show him and the public how simple this fella is. And I played around with him two or three rounds, too, which I should have opened up.
The crowd now senses that Ali is doing nothing, while Norton presumably may be punching himself out, so the crowd is beginning to boo. We saw Ali last night at a party, actually, just sitting there. You have to wonder if he's taking Norton too lightly. All right, we're back for round eight. And Ali just hasn't been right. And I think he may have cracked a tooth in his mouth, judging by the way he's holding his mouth.
I knew something was wrong, but I didn't know how serious it was.
You see the countdown on the clock? One has to wonder, has he gone stale from the constancy of fighting, no matter the caliber of opponent? One has to wonder, is it all suddenly going out? Is he now but a relic of the fighter he was? Tell you now,
six,
Kenny Norton
Ali,
has won the decision.
5 points, Norton. Ladies and gentlemen, referee Frank Rustich. 7 points, Norton. 5 points, Ali.
One of the greatest upsets again in boxing history. Muhammad Ali, I am told, suffered a broken jaw in the first round, and an unbelievable fight here today. Muhammad Ali would have talked to you, I'm sure. He couldn't because of the broken jaw. He has a broken jaw. He is a beaten man, and he is a broken fighter. And so all of the millions of dollars that loom before him with a Frazier rematch are suddenly gone. What was once a very great fighter becomes now part of mystic history in all probability.
Fight fans all over the world were shocked, really, when a relatively unknown boxer broke the jaw of a man who's been considered maybe the greatest fighter of all time and defeated him. And maybe this is the only man who can explain what happened that night. All sorts of people have been trying to piece it together. Do you think it was a lucky punch?
I really don't know. My mouth wasn't completely closed, I remember, but...
You can remember the moment that it happened, clearly?
Yeah.
You know when the jaw went?
Yeah. I don't make excuses, you know, for losing. So, but my major reason is because I didn't train properly, taking them for granted, mainly not living up to my religious convictions like I should.
If they told you tomorrow that you could not fight again, if they had a look at your jaw and said it's just too dangerous, would you cry?
No. I'd rejoice. I'd be glad that I found out before I killed myself.
championship of the world, the biggest event in all sports. The challenger for the heavyweight title, Big George Foreman. The undefeated champion, Joe Frazier, cemented his hold on the crown with a decision over undefeated Muhammad Ali in 1971. Foreman having a very good round. 20 seconds to go. Your plans for the future. Will you fight
Frazier again,
or will you fight Muhammad Ali?
Right now, that was my main goal, was to win the World Heavyweight Championship.
You got it now.
I'd like to go out and tell a lot of kids and preach it for a long time that all you got to do is work and pray hard. You can get anything you want. I'd like to spend my whole life giving that message out.
I want to see the inside of your house. Is this
it? Right. This is old antique house, replica of a 200-year-old cabin.
Did you design this yourself?
Designed everything. And just like the days of Jack Johnson.
No, come on here. Let me tell
you. Hey, I love what you've done with the place.
Oh, yeah, this is old antique. I did all this up myself, Dick. This is a 200-year-old rope bed here. Yeah. This table weighs about 850 pounds. This was made out of a real oak tree. This is old antique pheasant I picked up. The energy crisis don't bother me. I have coal oil lamps. I got the big old coal stove over here.
Yeah.
And the water pump right from the well under the ground. Everything's antique. I like the idea of getting up in the mornings, making my coal, getting the real natural heat. Something you don't get nowadays. Everything's just gas and electric. This is real, no pollution. This comes right out of the ground. Nice coal. Take a taste of that, dude.
No electricity in here.
No electricity.
How do you watch television?
No television. I'll go over in my kitchen to watch television.
What do you watch?
I watch the Johnny Carson show mostly. Dick have a show sometimes. Carton, who's got the most color guests on? I've been so publicized, I've won fights so easy and unmarked, and you can be intoxicated with not only alcohol or narcotics, but you can be intoxicated with greatness. And when a man's intoxicated, he'll do something that he wouldn't do otherwise. So now that I've been sobered up a little and realized that I can slip, that if I don't work like I should, then my mind might tell me to do something, but my body won't. Well, this is getting me more hungry like I used to be coming up.
Extraordinary stories on Sky Documentaries, powered by Jaguar.
'71, that's when I met my first pro fighter. He took me up to Muhammad Ali's training camp, and I met Muhammad Ali. I said, wow, I met the heavyweight champion of the world. Just to meet a star, a celebrity. And most kids don't get that opportunity.
I said, kid, your chances of being a great fighter are good enough to make a good living is about 100,000 to 1. And if you spend the most of your life trying to be a fighter, and you get hurt or you don't make it, your whole life is ruined. It's too late to get education. It's too late to look for a trade or something to fall back on.
He liked the way I boxed. And next thing you know, I had a job, a full-time job, being a sparring partner for Ali for like 4 years.
Operation Test the Jaw is not a karate movie starring Cary Grant. It is what Muhammad Ali calls his first sparring session since Ken Norton broke his jaw last March. This is all, of course, in preparation for Ali to break Ken Norton's jaw this September in Los Angeles.
I'm trim. My jaw is ready. Look at my body. Look at me. In perfect shape. 212 pounds. Same weight for Sonny Liston. I chopped down 85 trees for this fight. Talking about Norton closing my mouth. You tell Norton he opened my mouth wider. Don't believe that stuff. Predicting on the predictor. I'm going to be so fast. Watch what I'm going to do with my hands in the ring at night. I'm going to be so fast. If Norton doing dirty stuff, I'm going to reach him nowhere and pull out a long cane.
Even though Muhammad Ali is training for Ken Norton, his mind and his mouth stretch all the way to George Foreman.
Foreman, I don't know. George Foreman got the title just like Joe Frazier, killing the game. Frazier had the title 2 years, fought twice. I fought 12 times. Frazier, Foreman, haven't heard nothing about him since he fought Frazier. All his preparation to get ready for some man ranked number 22 in the top 10. He should fight the top-notch fighters. And after I annihilate Ken Norton, going to Jakarta, Indonesia, to whoop this Rudy Lubbers, the Dutch heavyweight champion, I want to come back and settle this whole thing with George Foreman. And for old time's sakes, I want to whoop Joe Frazier again right there in Madison Square Garden. Now, I'm tired. I got to go to work. I ain't got no time to be fucking playing and jiving. I'm working.
Remember in his locker room interview, we asked him, did he have on his dancing shoes? He has. This is the best I've seen Ali look since going back before the Joe Frazier fight.
For a year now, I've seen the layer of fat around the midriff, and you don't see it tonight.
If Kenny Norton beats this Ali, Kenny Norton is going to get some great, great respect.
First punch of the fight for Ken Norton, and he yelled at Ali.
Ali got him a split second.
When you're in the ring and you're hot and you're warm, you start it, and you train all the time, most fighters are used to getting hit, and they're just ready for it. They don't feel it. The punch that might hurt is a glass scrape that might tear your skin, or you might feel the burn from the leather, or a thumb might get in your eye. But you're talking to the wrong man now when you ask me how to feel to be hurt or hit.
Hook on the jaw of Norton. Another hook on the jaw of Norton. The crowd is going absolutely berserk as these fine heavyweights.
Fight of the year.
3 minutes of excruciating time for these well-conditioned performers on this round.
And he's on his toes again. He's on his toes. It's going the distance.
And there is the bell.
Judge John Tullis scores it 6-5. Ali. Judge George Letka scores it 6-5. Kenny Norton. Referee Dick Young sees it 7-5 to the winner. There's a very tired Muhammad Ali. Worn out. Hitting Cosell on the head, just like he should. Get him.
I got Ken Norton out of the way. Now I'm going to get Joe Frazier out of the way. When I'm through, you won't hear no more about Joe Frazier. I'm going to get Joe Frazier. I'm going to wipe out George Foreman. Then I'm going to go on and put two more pages in the book and get on out of this mess.
At Kennedy Airport this morning, Joe Frazier and his rock and roll group, the Knockouts, departed for a 6-week European tour.
Do you find there's more difficulty than fighting, or do you have to stay in the same shape to dance and sing as you?
Like, you have to keep the weight down, you know what I mean? So therefore, while you're on the stage, you keep the weight down, and it's much easier, you know? But let's say, after that, while performing, then that's something different. It's twice time as hard as boxing. Oh, she didn't bet high. As I pack my
bags to leave, thought she might start to cry. Who told him he could sing? He has no rhythm, no footwork, no class. He cannot talk. He got him a big band. He started traveling the world, thinking that he's going to sell them all out. But they said, Joe Frazier appears at this place in England. An arena held 10,000. 37 people showed up.
A jasmine mink coat for Joe Frazier. 54 skins of pure white mink. He's had this one made to wear especially for his upcoming fight with Muhammad Ali.
That's right, not in the ring, but
to the fight.
Oh, yeah, that's all. And then I guess after the party and just move around with it a little bit, you know. I like fashion, that's an important thing. I love it. And, you know, I like to see people look good. And so, therefore, to start from making people look good, make myself look good also.
A man like Frazier has a certain rough-looking look. So I have a sparring partner who reminds me of Joe Frazier, threw him all the way here.
What do you look at?
10,000 miles away. I think he's legit, reminds me of Frazier.
I know somebody else who
well, like Gorilla Jones! Gorilla Jones! Let him out! Let him out! Let him in. He can go around too. Gorilla Jones. Take your time, Gorilla. Are you ready?
This isn't a little corny.
Are you ready? This gets me ready for Joe Frazier. He resembles Joe Frazier.
All right. 1, 2, 3, make it fun.
see me get into that ring with Joe Frazier at 210 pounds, which is 2 pounds lighter than it was 10 years ago, this time I'll be dancing.
But people want to see a fight, not a dance. All that money to come and see you and I fight, right?
Dancing
and you
hard.
Gonna dance.
Dancing and whooping you and dancing.
Here comes Muhammad Ali. Here comes Joe Frazier.
When I get those little bitty gloves on and be real serious and no playing, no
standing corner. Wonder what they're gonna put on me.
Everybody know he's gonna have on gloves like
all
me.
Right, never. Why you talking like that's like another point?
We always have
right.
on the same.
All right,
we can just get the one now. We ain't got to make
Thank you, Ben Patrick. There's the bell at the end of round one. And Ali gave us the famous shuffle at the end of the round and goes back to his corner.
Have you ever considered you've taken lots of blows to the head, both of you, throughout your career, with the possibility of, say, permanent brain damage?
Anything could happen.
Yeah, cars.
You can wait up.
More people
up in the
are
morning.
Killed in this country in cars than war. And what are we going to do, quit driving cars?
We heard that. Let me tell it, put it in
and
way.
I know you're not concerned about two black bodies' brains being hurt that much now. I know you're not that wrapped up over our brains. You really worried about my brains? Anybody else's brains? We not worried about it. So why are we not worried about it? You should worry about what else is happening in the world.
But what kind of sport is it? Can it be?
What kind of sport is it?
Where a guy goes in a ring and gets his jaw broken.
Watch your handling. Watch your handling. What kind of sport is this? When a guy gets in a damn car in your country and go around a damn track and hit a pole and he burn up. Don't get on our little sport. We don't have nothing over in no way but a job, and few of us can't get nothing unless we can box. And now you want to run that out.
And the New York story. Round 12 coming up, Don. A lot depends right here. Now they shake hands, and here is Don.
Hit him with everything. The man took a terrible beating. He wouldn't fall. I said, "Y'all, you crazy?" I hit him there. I said, "You must be crazy." He said, "Yes, right. I'm crazy." He just kept coming. I'm crazy.
There they are in the center of the ring. What do you think about Muhammad Ali when you're in there like this?
Well, right now, you know, George Foreman and I have just been offered $5 million apiece by the government of Zaire. And if he can win this fight tonight, which I don't think he will, he'll have to defend his champion again in the Congo.
Oh, good right hand, the left-hand side of the face of Norton. Norton is a bit stunned as Foreman is teeing off, and it looks like Norton has really been staggered as he went up against the rope. Foreman's been banging on in the second round. Norton goes down again, the left hand on the side of the head. Legs are rubbery and the left hand goes to the side of the head. A right uppercut, a left jab, and a vicious left. And Norton crumbling to the canvas. Norton is in Swainsville. He doesn't know where he is. I don't know if Norton can make it. It might be all over right here. And it looks like it may be all over, and it is all over. George Foreman.
He hit Ken Norton just like he do all his opponents. Caught him arrow. This man depends on getting this man in the first one or two rounds. If he don't do that, he's frustrated. Stick him with left jabs and right crosses, tie him up and box him, and you will retire.
Ali.
I'm the only man that's going to whoop George Foreman, and I'm going to whoop him of all places in Africa, in the Congo, where the Lumumba boys are.
Ali, now that you have your cool about you and you calm down at this point, I want you to answer this question. How could that man go 24 rounds with you and only two with the heavyweight champion of the world?
Because George Foreman is not as good of a fighter scientific as I am, but I admit he's stronger and he hit harder. I'm not a hard puncher. I'm not known for being a hard puncher. I fought many men like Floyd Patterson, Sloan Foley, Charles Fowler, who are stronger than I am. Many I couldn't knock out, Sonny Liston. But I'll tell you this, boxing ability, speed, whooping him on points for the distance if necessary. Then I'll whoop him.
Well, fighting in your home territory, you couldn't be any happier the way this is coming up in September.
Why would you call Africa my home territory?
You've been telling me that for 10 years.
That's right, and if you come over there talking like that, we'll cook you.
That's it for Muhammad Ali.
Last night, I had a dream. When I got to Africa, I had one hell of a rumble. I had to beat Tarzan's behind first for claiming to be the king in the jungle. For this fight, I've wrestled with alligators. I've tussled with a whale. I done handcuffed lightning and put thunder in jail. You know I'm bad. I've murdered a rock. I injured a stone and I hospitalized a brick. I'm so bad, I make medicine sick. I'm so fast, man, I can run through a hurricane and don't get wet. When George Foreman meets me, he'll pay his debt. I can drown a drink of water and kill a dead tree. Wait till you see Muhammad Ali.
Under the auspices of President Mobutu, from the heartland of Africa, the World Heavyweight Championship Fight, this is the biggest, most expensive single sports event in history.
It was mind-boggling. You look around, you don't see but 200,000 black people, you know what I mean? Damn, whoa, you know?
This is an awesome bar of George Foreman against the boxing skills of Muhammad Ali.
Is this definitely whatever happened? Your last fight?
My last. This is the last.
Win or lose, it's your...
Ain't no such thing as lose. This is the last of Muhammad Ali. So enjoy the fight, get to the theater, and see the most scientific, the most creative, the most artistic, the most talked about, the most colorful, the most wisest mentally, the most controversial, the boldest, most courageous, the greatest fighter, the best looking physically. Of all times, this will be the last rumble, and I invite all of you to be there among those of us who dare to dare.
George Foreman hasn't gone in the past 4 years beyond two rounds in any fight. Can Ali dance and stay away from him?
Beforehand, you go into the ring and you want to go out there and execute some of the things you practice. This time, this man has, you know, gotten me to the point where I just distaste his presence in boxing. I really want to beat him. More than anything in the world, I want to beat him.
Just before the fight, I'm looking at him, and the man's giving his instructions. I said, sucker, you are in trouble tonight. You are fighting the greatest fight of all times. You said I was the greatest, but you're gonna see. I'm fast, sucker. I'm gonna burn you up. You're fighting your idol. When you were a little kid, you were hearing about me, you know. I said, you're meeting your master, your idol.
Here we go, Ali quickly across the round. Foreman a bit cautious in the first round, looking to drop that left hook.
First round, I laid in the corners, right? I said, come on, show me something. I talked through the whole fight. I said, show me something. They told me you could hit hard. You're just a sissy. Come on, you can do better than that, George. You want to corner me? Here I am. You waiting to corner me? You're the world heavyweight champion. You're the world. Come on, keep punching. I want you to get tired. I said, uh-oh. I said, this is the wrong place to get tired. This is the wrong place to get tired. He's breathing. I said, oh, you finished, boy. You are in trouble. I said, you don't have but two chances, slim and none.
As of now, Dave, that's the greatest of all time to shut up. So I got the whole critics and the boxing experts on a big spot because George Foreman was dangerous.
He was terrible. He was going to wear me down. He was going to get me in the corner and just murder me. And I, as always, I proved to still to be the greatest.
Right. Basically, did he scare you?
Yeah, I was scared to death.
I was reading a piece that Norman Mailer wrote about you, where he described you as the second most prominent American, second most prominent after Nixon. We might dispute that. But would you like to be president?
No.
No?
No, sir. Too dangerous. Like, in other words, here's a ship. People are dancing on the ship. A lot of money's on the ship. A lot of food's on the ship. And I cannot integrate on the ship. I cannot have equality on the ship. I'm just in the galley working. And I never could get up and see the captain of the ship. Now, all of a sudden, the man tells me, say, come on down, Ali, out of the galley. I want you to come up here and here, have something to drink. What do you want? And giving me number one spot. From the galley to the number one spot. I said, this ship must be sinking. Why is he, why is he so nice to me now? What moved him to call me up here? Black men have been males now. One might be the president. America's in too much trouble. I don't want that job now.
Extraordinary Stories on Sky Documentaries, powered by Jaguar.
See, I'm looking at the black people as a nation. We have prostitution problems. We got dope problems, gang fighting among self, a lack of love for self, no respect for our women. We don't have no property. We don't have no land. We worked 400 years to make this country the wealthiest country on the planet. This is our problem.
This poem is entitled Truth, T-R-U-T-H. The face of truth is open. The eyes of truth are bright. The lips of truth are ever closed. The head of truth is upright. The breast of truth stands forward. The gaze of truth is straight. Truth has neither fear nor doubt. Truth has patience to wait. The words of truth are touching. The voice of truth is deep. The law of truth is simple. All that you sow, you reap. The soul of truth is flaming. The heart of truth is warm. The mind of truth is clear and firm through rain and storm. Facts are but its shadow. Truth stands above all sin. Great be the battle of life. Truth in the end shall win. The image of truth is Elijah Muhammad. Wisdom's message is rod. The sign of truth is the crescent. The soul of truth is God. Life of truth is eternal. Immortal is its past. Truth has power to endure. Truth shall always last. Now, that's my masterpiece.
Very nice.
What we got over there?
Five best.
Boy, look at here. Oh, boy, a big pot of raw spinach.
How you burn this
thing? That's real iron.
Straight from the mountain of Muhammad.
This defensive tactic of laying against the ropes and allowing the opponent to wear himself out was employed in the Foreman fight, and Ali says it will enable him to prolong his career by 10 years.
Muhammad, I don't want to see you end up on Queer Street.
What do you mean? You mean like...
There's an old boxing term called queer street, which means
I
a guy who's...
I've never heard the term queer
oh,
street
come
in
on,
boxing.
Man.
Are you serious?
Queer, but not in boxing. You mean punch drunk?
Yeah, a guy who ends up, you know, without doesn't have the goods anymore. He's
well,
fought too long and
see,
is out
well,
there.
Well, that happens to people that get hit too much.
A little punchy.
And get you know, even a car accident, you'd be shook up. Brain can't damage so much.
Yeah.
Put the camera on close-up. I'm sure it's no, put the camera on close-up. Stop right there.
If you're in top notch shape, if you're experienced, you know how to stand there for a while. Like all these fellas threw shots all day. Didn't one come through?
Laying on the ropes a la Zaire, where he allowed George Foreman to punch himself
old tactic when George Foreman used himself up.
Every punch has been tired. And after three or four rounds of that with 15 to go, no contest.
Fighting is hard. Fighting hurts. You've been hurt less than most. Your face isn't marked up much. But was it fun or just a means to something?
Well, it was fun being seen on television, winning the Golden Gloves, wearing my jackets. Then you go through the stage where it's no longer fun, it becomes business.
After this fight, I'll hear no more about Joe Frazier because I will totally destroy him. This time I'll show you that he was a trap all the time. He was an illusion champion. He got the title because the draft took my title. Then when I came back, they had me because it was 4 years off. I got warmed up a little, I beat his behind. Now I'm really on top, not only on top, but having a crown back. And I'm gonna show you that I'm much older, much more wear and tear, more experienced, and I'm still the king of all kings, and he must lose in the round I choose.
This will be Ali's fifth fight in the last 12 months.
By comparison to the first two Frazier fights, the importance of this one, is it less than the first and more than the second, or how would you characterize it?
It's time now to show the people that I'm truly much, much, much more greater than he is, because he got his name when my title was taken because of draft reasons, then he built himself up. So he wasn't really a true champion. He didn't beat the champion. He was just a little substitute during my absence. After 4 years, they gave me a chance to come back. And then he was fighting a true champion, but it wasn't really fair. It wasn't too active. Second time, I was more active, and I danced 12 rounds with him. In the last two rounds, had a lot of fight left in me. Came back and beat him and Foreman.
This has to have been one of the most bruising heavyweight championships of all time.
Now I've had 41 rounds of fighting this year. He's only had 9. So now I have everything together about like it should be. So what I'm going to do to him this time, I have to show you this time what I should have done the first time.
Doctor comes up and looks at Frazier. I think it's going to be over. It's all over. Muhammad, can you say a word now around the world?
I'm surprised Joe has so much stamina. And if I didn't have the condition, I know I would have lost. This is too painful. It's too much work. Okay. Might have a heart attack or something. Right. I want to get up before I'm on top.
So I go beat up Joe Frazier. Okay, you beat Joe Frazier. Good fight. Tomorrow's another day. Who did I help? I didn't help nobody but myself. I like doing something worthwhile. Fighting is nothing. I think about people 45, 50, 60 years old getting up and going to work every day. They still go to work. And I'm about ready to retire, and I'm well established, and I'm 33.
The question tonight, and it may be very interesting indeed, is ballooned up to 230 pounds at 34 years of age. How great is Muhammad Ali now today?
Yes, I want to quit at the end of 76. And this year, we should make about $20 million more in 5 fights, which 80% of it I plan to donate to charitable causes.
I have never seen you so off in your timing, missing so many lefts and rights.
That's why I'm quitting this year.
If I don't take the money and give it to my people or some kind of way help, then I'm not doing nothing. So if we can't help people with our life and make a name that's going to live, ain't no sense in being here. Feel a funk, yo.
Muhammad Ali is guaranteed $6 million for putting his World Heavyweight Championship on the line against Ken Norton, who will earn about $1 million.
Some fool still thinks Norton can beat me after I destroyed his daddy, which is Foreman, after I destroyed Joe Frazier, who will destroy Norton. He still thinks he can fight with me, and people do too. So I have something still to prove. And after I'm through with Norton, I can say goodbye to everybody out there.
I think Kenny Norton is crying. It looks to me like he's crying. He must have thought he won the fight.
Are you my man or Norton's man?
I like you better than Carter or Ford.
Muhammad, since this is a political year, do you have a favorite among the presidential candidates? And more interestingly, has anyone asked you for support?
No, they haven't.
made a statement the other day about I'm not voting for no one.
Evangelista has gone the distance against Muhammad Ali.
I don't care what people really expect. All I care about is winning and getting paid and being the world champion and ready for another day.
Muhammad Ali, you have said that you would like to get out of boxing and carry a briefcase and be a sort of a black Henry Kissinger. Did your fight this week persuade you that maybe it's getting to be that time?
Yes, sir.
Have you bought a black briefcase?
No, I have a couple of briefcases.
Are you still the world's greatest fighter? Some people are now saying that you can sting like a bee, but you can't float like a butterfly anymore.
Well, I'm getting old now. I don't float like I used to. I'm a little slow now.
So you are getting past it?
Yeah, I'm getting old and I'm getting tired and might get knocked out soon.
The end of a boxing era came like a right hook out of nowhere last night in Las Vegas. A 24-year-old ex-Marine with a little over 1 year's professional experience dethroned the most famous boxing figure of all time as Leon Spinks wrested the heavyweight title from Muhammad Ali in a 15-round split decision.
Muhammad, on a day like this, the day of what will be your last fight forevermore, you find yourself thinking back over your whole boxing career, your whole life?
I probably will later, but not now. This fight that's coming up in a few hours is more important than all that I've done in the past. For the fact this is the last one, and I want to go out being the first black man to retire champion and the first man to gain it 3 times.
You sound almost tired. And the fight's at hand.
I'm not so tired until you're gonna hear it in my speech. I'm just relaxed. I'm not tired. I'm in top shape. Probably in better shape than I was with the thrill in Manila and George Foreman. Although I'm older, I've had a few fights since then, but this is befitting of me to do the impossible. I cannot consider myself the greatest of all times if I can't come back and get this title from the likes of a man like Spinks. I underestimated him first time. This time, you'll see the real Ali. I predict this camera to everybody watching this fight. And if I'm not telling the truth, you can play this thing over and show it to the public. Make me look like a fool. I will destroy Spinks.
Here's the bell and we're underway. That one, the champion Spinks coming right up against a moving and dancing Muhammad Ali. He's moving, he's dancing, he's been doing it for 6, now going on 7 minutes. No question, this is already a different story than the last time.
Ali is dictating the pace of the fight. Ali is dictating where he fights and when he fights. Stall Ali.
And a big round for the former champion.
Ali again in his complete control.
Starts the check, Ali.
He is showing a young Leon
can't think what it's like to be in with the real Muhammad Ali.
Tim Ali, one Iran, four things. 11 Ali, four things. Tim Ali, one Iran, four things. The new champion, Muhammad Ali.
This Ali is the world heavyweight champion for the
top story in sports is a report that Muhammad Ali, finally, at age 37, has officially retired as champion of the World Boxing Association.
I'm not going to set up, stand up, and do like many people I see going out.
It's been so good to me. I hate
to. I'm happy to be getting out. I mean, it's been hell.
Russia is invading a Muslim country, Asiatic country, looking probably to take all wells in Persia, looking to take fresh water ports, which could lead to nuclear war. My purpose in coming here was to try to stop that.
With Soviet invading forces in Afghanistan, we and the other nations of the world cannot conduct business as usual with the Soviet Union. That's why the United States has imposed stiff economic penalties on the Soviet Union. And I have notified the Olympic Committee that neither the American people nor I will support sending an Olympic team to Moscow.
If the African people help by not going to the Olympics, I figured this would help show the Russians and the world what they're doing.
There are two bad white men in the world, the Russian white man and the American white man. They're the baddest two men in the history of the world. And if these two white men start fighting, all those little black folks are going to be caught in the middle. So we all should try to help stop these two white fellows from fighting. Right?
White House officials say they expect a number of other countries to go along with Mr. Carter's request. That means a boycott.
Why do we go to the moon? Because it's there. Why are we trying to go to Mars? Because it's there. Columbus wouldn't have discovered America if he didn't take a risk. So he who is not courageous enough to take risk will accomplish nothing in life. I'm a risk taker.
I'm now shooting for immortality.
But you got immortality now. Nobody's ever going to surpass that.
Not
record.
Four times.
Four-time
world champion. They might surpass three, but if I get four, I know they won't do five. Plus, I know Larry Holmes. I trained him. I taught him everything he knows. I taught him everything he knows, but not everything I know.
Oh.
And that's where the surprise is coming in. He thinks, he really believes he can beat me.
Yeah. Howard Cosell is saying the same things about you that Larry Holmes is saying about you. Well, he is. He said publicly, he said Ali is finished. I didn't say it. Don't look at me like that. William Mahal, stand over. He said it, Mohammed. And Larry Holmes said, you are 38 and over the hill. No way. No way, right? See? What do you say?
I'm lost for words.
Have you got a nickname for him yet?
Well, he's got a peanut shape here. I named him the peanut.
The peanut?
And I says, after the fight, I'm gonna shell you, pack you up, and send you to Plains, Georgia.
Holmes, unbeaten in 26 fights.
There's the left, and down went Ocasio.
And Holmes lands a crushing right uppercut that sends Weaver sprawling for the ring ropes.
Introducing the WBC heavyweight champion, Ken Norton. Weighing in at 209 pounds, hailing from Easton, Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania, the Eastern Assassin, Larry Holmes.
Ring round one is just underway. As you know, the world title at stake. No damage done. Larry Holmes is actually a bit taller. Maybe by a half an inch, maybe as much as an inch.
Some of those tassels like that that Muhammad Ali wore the first time he met Joe Frazier at the playoff, Larry Holmes has them on. He's copied everything from Ali.
I eat him up. Get back.
One more fight now. And he's not doing what he has to do to win.
Do you pray a lot to Allah yourself?
About five times a day.
Five times a day? Are they set prayers or ad-lib? Do you think them up as you go?
Well, usually when we're in cars, on airplanes, you have to just say them to yourself. But we have some probably over 100 different prayers. Prayers for success, prayers for traveling, prayers for victory, and for many things.
Do you pray for victory in fights?
All the time.
If I was fighting a young Frazier in his prime, a young Sonny Liston, a young George Foreman, I wouldn't do it. But I can beat Larry Holmes. He's the man I trained, I know I can beat him. I see his weak points, he's tired after 8 rounds, and I just want to do it.
Oh, Holmes in trouble.
He dances like me, he tries to tell jokes like me, he tries to do ripple-dribble like me, he tries to write poems like me. Everything he do is me. When he meet the real me, meet his idol, he's gonna freeze. I'm gonna do him in.
I mean, you guys spent time sparring together. You spent a lot of time outside the ring together. Is it difficult to go in there with a friend?
I don't want to fight Muhammad. Muhammad is a legend. Right. Let him stay home in his rocket chair. Stay home, old man. You don't need me. Right. Take it and run.
The biggest question I'm getting is, why are you doing it? The reason is, I'm out to conquer immortality.
He won't go 8 rounds, I predict it. Hollywood fall, the old man is in deep trouble.
Fighting out of Louisville, Kentucky, introducing Muhammad Ali. Fighting out of Easton, Pennsylvania, he is the WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Larry, the Easton Assassin, Holmes. 15 rounds of boxing.
I have a poem for you.
Give me a poem. Here it comes.
Suck Ali it. Comes out to meet Holmes, but Holmes starts to retreat. If Holmes goes back in his father, he'll wind up in a ringside seat.
Holmes hasn't caught him yet, but Ali hasn't thrown any punches yet either.
Ali swings to the left. Ali swings to the right. Look at Ali carry the fight.
Holmes is not intimidated by him.
No, I'd say they both respect each other, despite what they're saying.
Holmes keeps backing, but there's not enough room. It's a matter of time that Ali loads the boom.
And Ali's only thrown one punch in 2 rounds.
Now he lands with the right. What a beautiful swing, and the punch lifts Holmes clean out of the ring.
Whoa! Kind of sad at this point to think how great Muhammad Ali was in his prime, and to see a man that's just kind of trying to, looks to me, hang on and keep the thing going for one more time.
Holmes is still rising, but the referee wears a frown, for he can't start counting till Holmes comes down.
Good combination by Larry. Ali clowning again about the knee.
We can't believe it. Holmes disappears from view. The crowd is getting frantic.
Yeah.
But our radar stations have picked him up.
Yeah.
He's somewhere over the Atlantic.
The whole attack for Holmes is centered on the head of Ali.
Who would have dreamed when they came to the fight that they witnessed the launching of a colored satellite?
You get the idea that Muhammad Ali might explode at any time, too.
I don't think he's figured something to do.
Friendship is a priceless gift that cannot be bought nor sold. But its value is far greater than a mountain made of gold. For gold is cold and lifeless, it can neither see nor hear. In time of trouble, it's powerless to cheer. Gold has no ears to listen, no heart to understand. It cannot bring you comfort or reach out a helping hand. So when you ask God for a gift, be thankful if he sends not diamonds, pearls, or riches, but the love of real true friends.
Well, the end of round 10.
Stand and keep going. What a courageous stand.
He handled it with dignity.
Angelo Dundee wants to stop the fight. That's it. They stopped the fight at TKO. It'll be
scored. I did what I had to do. And I still love the guys. I don't care what nobody says. You're another athlete.
Was the emotion at the end of the fight really the sadness of beating your idol?
Yes, it is. But you know, we all come, we all go, and having this man left, but he believed so strongly in himself, he thought he could beat me, so he came back, gave me a try. You can't knock a man for trying.
Okay.
I always respect the man. People all around the world respect the man, and he's going down in the history as one of the greatest fighters of all time, especially at my time.
Larry, I'd like you to explain why you've been crying.
You know, so I really respect a whole lot, really respect Ali a whole lot.
It hurt you to punish him that way, didn't it?
I feel that he fought one of the baddest heavyweight in the world today, and you cannot take credit from him.
How are you feeling, Sammy?
How do I feel? I feel with my hands. Why is there so many press over here?
You glad to be back in England, Mohammed?
Oh, yeah, I'm always glad to be back in England. I love England. I'm glad the sun's shining. And I don't see no rain and fog today.
Mohammed, the $64 question. Are you going to box again, Mohammed?
I shall return.
Who will your opponent be, Mohammed?
My managers and trainers are there negotiating. Probably some top contender. My mind is not 100% sure yet. I can do better than I did the last time at home.
You haven't finished with boxing, definitely. Can you tell the world that?
That's right.
You're still in there.
You're not as dumb as you look.
Thank you. Thank you.
Judge Alonzo Butler votes it 97-94. Judge Clyde Ray votes 99-94. Judge Jay Edson votes 99-94. Unanimous decision for Trevor Burbick.
There you have it. Trevor Burbick.
Has it settled in your mind now after losing? This is it for you. You should never come back in this ring again.
I'm sure that this is enough to convince me. I didn't get hurt. I saw the shot. Couldn't take him. Father Time just got it.
It looked to us at ringside that, you know, you were slow. You were telegraphing your punches. The eyes could see it, but the physical ability just couldn't get it there.
That's right. I think that's the trouble. Father Time called. In my young days, I wouldn't have had much trouble. But I think time got it.
And this is it for you?
I'm sure this is it. I'm sure I won't wake up next week. Santa Cumber, as of now, I'm retired. I don't think I changed my mind.
Muhammad, thank you so very much. And thank you from all of us around the world.
Thank you.
Thank you.
got a piece of paper?
Did you pay a dollar?
What?
Did you pay a dollar? I was joking. Get a piece of paper.
Okay, come on.
They're gonna say he's got brain damage. He's fighting horses.
Everything God created has a purpose. Trees have a purpose. The moon has a purpose. Rain, snow, cats, dogs, everything have a purpose. And the wise man is he or she who knows the life purpose.
In this situation, every head must bow, every tongue must confess. This is the greatest war. Yeah.
Send a good compliment. Mm-hmm. The man is great.
You think he could hit harder than Ernie Shavers?
What do I think? Are you colored?
Most surely, God's highest form of life, human beings have a purpose, and the wise man is he or she who knows the life purpose.
Saddam Hussein has allowed the guests to return to America with us.
The first question that we should deal with is a very sensitive area. Everybody talks about Muhammad Ali's health, Muhammad Ali, and obviously the things that you're going through now. Would you like to comment on that?
I have what they call Parkinson's syndrome. It causes a tremor in your hands and affects the speech. So all that old talk, I'm the greatest, I have to slow down now.
It seems to bug other people more than it does you. When I sit and talk to you, you seem to be fine with the speech and everything.
Sometimes. And don't bother me, but I hope he gets better.
Yeah, yeah. We're all praying for you. We're all praying for you.
My purpose was to be a heavyweight champion and live a clean life, and in spite of all the money and all the fame, and do all I can to help other people.
I'm just going to show you a picture, and you can react to it any way you want to. You can't talk. Now, I know you can talk. You talked to me, you talked to Lonnie, you talked to Howard.
On this day, he didn't want to talk. In his kitchen, away from the microphone, Ali explained that he didn't want people to feel sorry for him, didn't want to be pitied, didn't want people to say, poor Ali, he fought too long. He still has no regrets about what boxing did to him because of what boxing has done for him.
Ali. Touch it.
No, well, hello. Sometimes he does that.
Huh?
It happened after the Frazier fight in Manila.
What happened?
I don't know. I wasn't there. But ever since the Frazier fight in Manila, Muhammad will, it's sort of like narcolepsy. He'll just start sleeping, but he'll have these flashbacks, and he'll have, it's like nightmares, and his face will twist up like he's boxing, and he'll throw punches at people. And he does it at night sometimes. Sometimes I have to get out of the bed. Whenever he starts snoring heavily, I have to get out of the bed because I know it's going to start.
Right. So when he starts,
what's the next room?
So he's not putting on when he's
starting. This actually happens. Mm-hmm. And the doctor told us not to really try to wake him if that does happen, because he might end up with a heart attack because mm-hmm. it might frighten him. Mm-hmm. So I don't. I just get up and move. Mm-hmm. That's the hard part. You have to sort of...
question right up here in the balcony here. Right, sir.
Mohammed, I'd like to know what you're going to do when you retire from boxing.
I think he's probably taking the last count at the moment. I'll do my best to wake him up.
You sleep. That's all I'm going to do.
That's all he wants to do when he retires.
Now, when I retire from boxing, I really don't know. I want to say something right here. This might make you all think. What I'm going to do when I get out of boxing is to get myself ready to meet God, because God is watching me. He wants to know, how do we treat each other? How do we help each other? So this is a test to see where will we spend our life in heaven and hell, and that's eternity. This is not the life now. Your real self is inside you. Your body gets old, but your soul and your spirit never die. So when I die, if there's a heaven, I want to see it. So God is testing us on how we treat each other, how we live, to see where our real home be in heaven.
Misery. Now all our suffering and pains are part of history. We came in chains. You must remember that, for that and that alone explains exactly where we're at. We came in chains. We came as living loot, so you could boast slave gotten gains. We've grown beneath your boot. We came in chains, and how our blood was spilled, together with our sweat, it stains this nation we helped build. We came in chains, we didn't volunteer, and yet today the fact remains, we'll still held captive here. We came in chains, now I say cut us loose, though that may go against your grain, still there's no excuse. We came in chains, now who down there's gonna bear the cost, till every one of us regains the freedom we have lost. We came in chains, and now your choice must be to either blow out all my brains or else just set me free.
I'm writing the greatest short poem of all time. This poem tells how it feels to be as great as me. This is it, the greatest short poem of all time. Me, wee!